Today, we're here to talk a little bit about the unfortunate incident that happened to Tiger Woods. It's my understanding that he was involved in a motor vehicle crash, and unfortunately, he sustained some, what it sounds like, are some very severe injuries to his lower extremities. My name is Charles Jordan. I'm an orthopedic surgeon with the Miami Orthopedics and Sports Medicine Institute. My specialty in my practice is orthopedic trauma, which is the care of injured patients who have had significant injuries, especially fractures due to high energy situations like car accidents. I've heard that he unfortunately sustained what's called an open tibia and fibula fracture. The tibia is the bone that you can feel down where your shin is, and the fibula is the smaller bone that's just on the outside of that. And this injury happens very frequently when you have accidents like car accidents or falls from height or something that what we consider high energy. And an open fracture is when fractures break through the skin and are exposed to the environment. And this is one of the injuries that I've read that he sustained. The significance of this is that when the bone comes out, there's a high risk of infection. And it's considered an emergency because we want to minimize that risk of infection. And it's very common to take patients to the operating room as quickly as possible when that's the case. Another thing that I've read he sustained is a compartment syndrome. And compartment syndrome happens when a trauma is severe enough where the swelling inside the tissues can compromise the blood supply to the limb. And so there is a particular type of surgery that's done in order to relieve pressure in the leg in order for a patient to avoid a limb-threatening condition. These sorts of injuries are best treated right away. And if he was treated in a very timely fashion, which it sounds like he was, and was taken immediately to a center where they were prepared to take care of that, I would even venture to say that they may have saved his limbs and, if not, also his life. In general, these sorts of injuries are initially treated with what we call initial debridement and stabilization. So an open fracture, the first and foremost tenet in treatment is to clean out the fracture site, to remove any contamination or to remove any tissue that is too destroyed or too damaged that may contribute to an infection or to any other complication. And so this gets done in the operating room. Everything gets what we call debrided, which is this cleaning process, and then stabilization. There are times in which we can place implants into the bone that are going to stay in forever and are going to hold the bone in place until the bone is able to heal on its own. There are other times when we place temporary devices. For example, there's something called an external fixator where we will actually place pins that go into the bone and are attached to a frame that's outside the body. And these frames are meant to hold the bones in place temporarily until the time comes where we can exchange those implants for other implants that are more permanent and inside the body. One reason why they may happen is if there is an excessive amount of contamination or if there is any other sort of situation in which placing implants into the body would be disadvantageous at that time, you could do that as a temporizing measure. When it comes to these sorts of injuries and patients of mine who have these injuries, I get asked very frequently questions about the implants that I'm putting in. Do they need to come out? That's a very common question. And the answer can change from injury to injury. But in general, when we put implants in the body, they're designed to be able to hold the bone in place in order for the bone to heal in the right place and in the right spot to give you back your function. And so generally speaking, once that's done, the implant can stay in your body and it's not going to do anything to you. You don't do anything to it. So we don't generally, for most procedures, plan to take implants out. They can stay in forever. And a lot of times you don't even feel that they're there anymore. Other questions really involve recovery time. And recovery time is very different for everybody. You know, some people say, how long will it take me to recover? And all they're saying is, how long will it take me to be able to go out and go to the grocery store, go out and go to work? For a gentleman like Tiger Woods, who is an extraordinary athlete, when he's asking his doctors, what is my recovery time? He may be thinking, what is the time for me to be able to participate in the highest levels of athletics that I'm used to participating in? And so what I would say is that patients, every patient is very different. And we treat patients very, very differently with regards to what goals we set and when. We want patients to get to their absolute highest level of function, but the journey in which they take to get there, or the questions that we ask and answer along the way may be very different. And so doctors like me really tailor treatment very specifically based on not just a patient's age and what they do for a living and what kind of activities they're used to, but what we think they're going to do when. These injuries are very severe injuries. It's generally speaking, a very long recovery process. With my patients, I counsel them at length about taking everything day by day. And first, the old adage says you have to crawl before you walk. And so there are some extraordinary people out there, especially professional athletes and elite athletes, who are able to overcome very severe insults to their body. And Tiger Woods is certainly one of the greatest athletes we've ever seen. And I would say that there is probably a lot that he's going to do to surprise a lot of doctors in how much he's able to do in his life from this point forward. And you kind of have to just take it day by day, and you have to be able to appreciate every single level that you achieve without really coming to a conclusion this early as to what he's going to be able to do and not to. And part of that is just part of the process really involves setting goals that the patient is going to feel like they want to do. So I wish him all the best.